Petrol prices are going to rise at midnight Wednesday to their highest level in Kenya's history based on rising crude oil prices. Now, a brief from the energy regulator indicates that petrol will increase by 4.3 shillings to 127 shillings per litre in Nairobi, while diesel is expected to rise from 107 shillings to 109, highest level since December of 2018. So joining us to discuss this further is Lawrence Messi, analyst with Financial Derivatives Company Limited. Lawrence, what is incentivizing the pipeline vandalisms that we're seeing in Nigeria? Go right ahead, Lawrence. Sorry about that.
Good morning.
Thank you for having me again.
So the reason for pipeline vandalisms are largely under two subheadings.
Right.
One is the personal and the second is the commercial. So for personal, we have a demographic in Nigeria where majority is below the poverty line. So of course, the cost of petrol, cost of fuel and other crude products might be too high, especially for the below average Nigerian citizen. Mm. So they cannot continue to bear this cost in generating sets, in transportation. And so obviously when a desperate man becomes too desperate, there's no telling what he can do.
Right.
And as a result of this, they go towards vandalism to get these products for free and also so that they can hoard them for future use. Then moving to the commercial aspect of everything, crude oil has been a lucrative commodity for the better part of 50, 60 years.
Indeed,
and there's no denying that, especially looking at the way prices are even rising this year, it's also testament to that fact. So people would like to smuggle, they like to vandalize pipelines to acquire this, and then they like to smuggle it to regions that are not as serviced in terms of crude oil and fuel products, that it can sell, make a huge margin and a huge profit. And this also accounts or tells us the story of why there is the black market existing in Nigeria.
Exactly. Now, what about the ability of security agencies to be able to guard these pipelines, given the prevalence of, you know, the vandalisms that we've been seeing?
Thank you for that question. These security agencies usually have their own mandate, their own specific functions. So I'm not so sure if these mandates fall under protecting pipelines. And also, Nigeria has about 5,000 kilometers in terms of pipeline distance. And there are also new projects coming up as well. There's an AKK project, about 600 kilometers. So using these security agencies to defend these pipelines would be stretching them too thin, and they won't be able to actually carry out their own functions of protecting the citizens and other mandates of them. So yes, in theory, when you do the math and you calculate the distance over the number of personnel, yes, there'd be enough people to guard these pipelines. But you're looking at what's the opportunity cost while they are protecting these pipelines and what's not being done.
Right.
So it's actually better for the government to actually initiate public-private partnerships with private security agencies to help and mobilize security along these pipelines.
Okay, see, great points. Now, Nigeria, as you know, has gas aspirations. We were going to be contributing more pipelines to the general network. I think it's the most in Africa, so 35-40%, if not more. So what's the strategy to be able to protect them when they come on stream?
All right, that's actually really good. First and foremost, there has to be sensitization across these rural communities that will be especially affected by delaying the groundwork for these pipelines. This is because the people affected need to know what's going on.
Right.
Secondly, there needs to be a plan to develop these rural communities. There need to be opportunities for employment and revenue generation. When these are not there, the youths and other desperate people will go into vandalism. So when these two things are achieved, then there now needs to be an inter-country agreement, rather, on what can be done to protect this pipeline. And then there will also have to be mobilization of public-private partnerships of security agencies so that a segment of security agencies are used and then private security firms are also contracted across different countries to ensure safety of this new increased pipeline project.
Great stuff. Now, still on oil and gas, there's a report, I think it was in The Guardian, it's only been seen in The Guardian so far, that the federal government could possibly extend the subsidy regime for another few months, maybe 3-4 months or so. This is what they found out. Now, unconfirmed, but again, it's the Guardian that is stating this. Now, if the reverse, now I don't know if that's going to be extended because we just looked at our reports with rising debt levels. So the math doesn't really work for me. But in the reverse, say you ended subsidy today, deregulated the downstream sector. Now, of course, prices go up. But what do you think happens to the amount of vandalism we've seen if that was to happen?
In a recent statement by the GMD of NNPC, Mr. Kyari,
yes,
he said that oil price should be trading at market levels, mm-hmm. or fuel price rather should be trading at market levels, which is between 212 to 234 naira per liter.
Yes.
So if the subsidy were to end today, as you suggested, then that would be the range that oil price could be selling, or fuel price rather, and it could even be higher depending on the amount of demand and the panic and whatever fueling stations decide to do. So if this were to happen, this would be an increased cost for businesses, an increased cost for the general household in transportation, in empowering their generating sets, considering that there is also ecstatic power supply in Nigeria. So the below average Nigerian would obviously be tempted or be forced to partake in pipeline vandalism as well. And this will also increase black market activity, especially because people will now be desperate to get oil from anywhere, and they might also be rationing as well. So that's the impact of a removal of subsidy today.
Now, I want to move over to what's happening in Kenya. Midnight tonight, prices are going to go up to their highest level that's in Kenya's history, I guess, since December 2018. I guess, what do you make of what's happening over there? Because it wasn't too long in South Africa. It happened by a month or two ago. And the reason was, we said, because crude oil prices were rising. So what do you make of the development in Kenya?
Well, it's highly attributable to, like you said, the fact that oil prices are rising. So this is affecting them because they are not an oil-producing country. So
right.
they are importing this crude. So it's basically a raw material. It's a cost to them. And so because the price is rising, then that cost is also increasing. And so inevitably, fuel price has to increase as well. Now, what Nigeria can make from this is the fact that it needs to be careful. It needs to re-strategize. Nigeria is an oil-producing country, so this shouldn't be affecting us. But what's affecting us is the fact that our refineries are not working. They are moribund. So we export crude, and we import refined crude.
Indeed.
So we are just taking back the cost. Mm. We're using the revenue we've made to incur more cost.
Right.
And so we are no better than non-oil producing countries. So there has to be a revitalization of refinery structures in Nigeria. That way, that cost of importation is completely eliminated. And when that's done, the government now actually has liberty within their budgetary framework to provide subsidies. And this does not have to impact our debt profile and our expenditure profile. So these are lessons Nigeria can take from Kenya and South Africa.
Got less than a minute to go. I would then assume that, of course, the upcoming Dangote refinery and to some extent the $1.5 billion price tag to revamp the Port Harcourt refinery can hopefully get us along the way that you're talking about to not have to be in Kenya's situation.
Surely it can.
All right. Well, we'll see how things go. Lawrence Messi, analyst at Financial Derivatives Company Limited. Thank you so much for joining us.